All right, everybody, please take your seats. The bizarre briefing is about to begin. I'm Bryce Castillo. This is a pretty good intro, right? We're having this thing where we don't know how to start the show.
We haven't started yet, have we?
What?
Did we? Was that the start?
I thought so.
Wait, dial it back. So, how did you start it?
I
wasn't even paying attention.
Everybody take your seats.
What I heard was...
The bizarre briefing is about to start.
And then there was an awkward silence, and he goes, that was a pretty good start.
Nailed it.
Which maybe that could be your signature.
Guys, this show is great. I love it.
That's Brandt Hughes ribbing me to death. And you might know that voice as distinctly not John Tilton.
Give or take. Maybe I am John Tilton.
I mean, you could. I haven't seen John in
days. Have you ever
seen
us in the same room at the same time?
Wouldn't that be crazy if that actually happened? It's like, no, I haven't.
Best illusion
seen
ever.
We got Brian on the show today.
Howdy, guys.
Yeah.
Brian.
Here for a limited announcement or engagement. I got to run down. The rest of that those Mr. Robot episodes aren't going to watch themselves for tonight's cord killers.
Oh, sure. Okay. Well, we'll have you on for as long as we can have you.
Yeah.
You like it.
Our first topic. So, why don't you listen to the show?
You know what? Because I don't want... I want you guys to have the freedom to say or do what you want without worrying about what Brian thinks about it. I do peek in live.
Oh, I have
live.
The freedom.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I was thinking about that exact thing today, Brandt, is that Brian being on the show almost ensures that he will never listen to it.
No. I mean, in fact, I do enjoy peeking in on it live, but it's like, it's to me, it's like the whole, it's for example... You know, Night Attack, Cord Killers, or whatever. That's all The Office. And then downstairs, you got the Warehouse. And you guys are the people that make The Office possible. And it's like The Warehouse is kind of a show. People don't come down from The Office to be on The Warehouse People's show. Mm-mm. This is your show.
We all saw that episode of The Office. It doesn't work out.
Is there really an episode
there
of The
is.
Office?
There
okay,
is,
see?
Definitely.
See? This is, I'm up in The
Spoiler
Office.
Spoiler alert, lot of shit gets broken.
I mean, I hope you're not offended.
No,
are you
fine.
Guys offended?
No.
I mean, I figure if there are particularly great bits or cross references, I figure that what will happen is you guys will develop your own regular bits, and then there's going to be like cross bleed as your show gets tighter, and then all of a sudden your memes will start showing up, and I'll be
wait,
what's that a reference to? And then everyone's going to be like, you got to watch the bizarre briefing, dog.
You know, someone didn't get briefed this month. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Well, it's a very insightful podcast. As you will find out, I'm sure.
See, and I don't know which way you're spelling insightful at this point, and could go either way.
Yeah.
That was too deep. Did I go too deep? I went too deep.
A little bit. Maybe a little bit.
All right. So this is our, July? What month is it? Month I forget what month it is. July edition?
July. This is our July edition.
July. Barely July. Now it's about to be August.
Well, we do it at the end of the month.
Oh, got it.
So we can recap the month.
Yeah. I would know that if I'd watched you in
previous episodes.
All right.
So we need to finish off your saga, Brandt.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
So last month you had just broken the lease of your apartment.
Terminated.
You're right, terminated. Yeah. But that's a different thing. And you are now fully moved into your new abode.
Yeah, July 6th was my move-in date, something like that. It took me like 2 days to move in.
Nice.
But yeah, I moved into a new place, and it has doubled the cost of living, so that kind of sucks. But, like... It's real nice.
Yeah.
You got
your own space, bro.
Yeah, and then it's like, it's really close to... Southwest Parkway or whatever, and I really like that road.
Yeah,
I started driving on it to get to like all my regular fast food places.
Southwest Parkway, that's the one that's north of 71 or 22.
Yes.
22. That's like the back way to take you out to Thomas Springs. Do you come down Circle Drive? I know it's a pretty road if it's the one.
You got any directions?
Yeah, it's real nice.
Allow me to give everyone directions to my house.
I saw the little video that you shot about your battery pack, which was cool. It was a cool video.
Yeah.
And I noticed the apartment seemed still a little bare. Have you gone and gotten
Definitely.
Any furniture yet? Do you have...
I got a washer and dryer.
Okay.
Woo. Which is a step, mm-hmm. right? I still don't have a bed. I'm using your inflatable bed. Yeah.
Nice.
I don't have a desk yet. So right now all my monitors and stuff are on...
the floor?
Are on containers that I would put like just storage stuff in. And then I have like my mouse and stuff on my countertop over by the kitchen.
Can I ask, where did you get the washer dryer? Did you Craigslist it or did you buy stuff new? Or
got it new from Home Depot, I believe.
Wow.
So like $1,000, something like that. They're having, you know, good 4th of July deals. And
you
stuff.
Know, oh, yeah. It's such a gamble. I'm a big fan of taking the Craigslist gamble because, yes, you can get burned, but so much stuff like this desk right here I got for $50 on Craigslist. And it is a beast. It's, you know, I wanted something
super... It's less pretty, like, it's pretty stable and, you well, know, yeah, as far and as it's desks like, go.
You know, and mounted the stuff on there. And our washer dryer, when we moved in here, I remember, I think it was $600 in cash from Craigslist. And I remember thinking, this is a gamble. It may break tomorrow. Mm-mm. But it's been 8 years now, and they're still going strong. So I'm just like, victory. But I'm a fan of taking the gamble, since it seems like more often than not, you come out a winner.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's Brian. When I set up my Roth IRA, I went the conservative route. On a scale of 1 to 10, I went with a 3.
Okay, got it.
I tend to go the new route and say, like, I'm getting it fresh. I know what to expect. Mm-hmm. It's going to cost more, sure, but...
Well, it makes sense, because when you get it on Craigslist, I mean, an Indian may have been sacrificed on it, and it's all haunted. It's like, you know, when you get it, you know whatever blood is going to be on the new desk as your murder blood.
Like, I just want my blood.
That's right.
Just my blood.
And just your ghosts. Pure blood. Only your spirits. Yeah, sure, okay. Sure. I totally see that.
I can handle those. But yeah, I also don't have a couch or anything like that. So my living room is just like a couple boxes full of like cables and stuff.
Sure. It's like that photo of when I moved into my apartment and I had that one green IKEA chair in the middle of an empty living room.
The saddest photo ever taken.
I was eating a Chipotle burrito on the ground because I didn't have anywhere for my laptop to be.
But there's kind of a joy in that too, because I remember you know, when we bought our first home, I remember I couldn't wait to move in, and so we brought sleeping bags and our dogs, and there was literally no furniture. We just spent the night listening to the miserable traffic noise because we didn't realize how loud it was going to be because we backed up to the highway, and we're like, and just even though it was nothing but disappointments, we're like, yay, look at us, we're in the new space.
Yeah. There's definitely something very free and liberating about living out there.
Oh, geez. That's very free and liberating.
A chair and a laptop.
The Jack Bauer style torture room that was my apartment for like a couple of days. Like, I remember I had a pod and the scheduling got messed up on that. Not mixed up.
But yeah. And then, you know, parking's a little rough. But other than that, like, it's real nice. It's a little pricey, you know. Like, I just had to put down my deposit on utilities and stuff.
Oh yeah,
which kind of sucks. But outside of that, I think it'll work out. It should be good.
That's glad. I'm glad that the space is working out for you.
Yeah.
Because I feel like, because this is your first like your space apartment, right?
Yeah.
Like, I think there's an amount of anxiety that comes with that, of just being like, this is property. I am someone who has this property, and it's mine, and it's my space, and it's like up to me to populate it, I could set roots here, even just tiny, you know,
baby roots.
Yeah. Are you having like any anxieties about it?
None in that capacity, but I definitely had a ton of stress and anxiety going into it, because, you know, it was, I mean, it was like when I had to go to college, right? I was like, oh, there are a billion colleges and they all cost $1 million. And I don't know. And so I ended up waiting.
Pick the right one.
Yeah. And so I ended up waiting till past all of the deadlines. And then I was just like, well, I know I can go to this community college over here because they don't really care. So I went to that community college and it worked out great. And this was sort of the same thing. Like, I was kind of putting it off. And there are like a million choices and they're all really expensive. And then like the flood just kind of pushed me to, okay, well, now I guess I have to come down on some kind of decision. And then I just landed on this place. And, you know, the whole time I was living here, you know, it was like, my body was acting real weird because of like just all that stress and anxiety was affecting me of like, oh, I don't know what I have to buy. I don't know who I have to set up accounts with. Mm-hmm. I don't know like what I need to move in, what I need to move out, what kind of papers I have to sign. Like, who knows?
Yeah.
But now that I'm settled in, it's totally fine. Like,
it's cake.
I've got stuff set up and I'm good to go.
Now, when you say living here, you mean in Austin or when you were crashing here during
your house.
Oh, yeah. Oh, because you knew you were going to move and you didn't know what all was involved or just being around the loud screaming turmoil chaos that is the Brushwood house at all times.
That probably didn't help a ton.
especially as just as you're going to bed is when all the guinea pigs of house go, you know, start running around in circles. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's also like, back then, there was the thing of me feeling like, I absolutely cannot let myself feel comfortable here. You know, like, when I was here, it probably took me 3 or 4 weeks before I felt comfortable moving my toothbrush into the bathroom.
Yeah.
Whoa.
And even then, like, I kept everything under the sink, like, hidden away and stuff. But... yeah, like, I mean, it's always kind of crazy, like, putting yourself in that kind of situation where you're living off of the generosity of others, and then
you have to sort of maintain your own expectations and like, well, not comfort, but just like what your body subconsciously expects.
Well, and it's weird because there's some unspoken, but it's like you're aware that you're not spending any money to be there, but you're also aware that you're burning emotional bank account the entire time, and you want to be mindful of that, and a, you know, courteous neighbor and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Which, by the way, you did a great job. I mean, it was great.
I think it probably helped that you guys were gone for
gone
two
half
of those
the
weeks.
Time. Yeah. Yeah. That's glad. I'm glad you've got a little fortress of brantitude.
Yeah, Waffleophagus asked if that was an intentional I don't want to feel comfortable or a subconscious thing. I think a mix of both. It was definitely a conscious thought that I had throughout the process of just like, I think the most dangerous thing I can do is feel like I'm not a burden here, you know, because then it's like, then it's been 3 months and it's like, well, we love to have you here, but
get the fuck out.
What's going on, buddy?
You want to be out of there before the, so how's that apartment hunting
right,
going?
Yeah.
Start slipping in. Yeah.
And then once I moved in, it was like, this is great. I love that I'm not here anymore. I feel really good about that.
Mm. That's great.
Yeah.
I'm glad.
It's great.
I don't know if you know this. In a couple of days.
Uh-oh.
Got the big show. Well, the big show. Not the biggest show, but the big show. Nerdtacular.
Oh,
2K15.
It is con season.
It's con season.
That time of year.
Con fever, catch it. This is my first Nerdtacular, and I think this is my first time traveling with you, Brian.
Yeah.
That knowing nod from Brandt.
And I'm not gonna say I'm not worried about it. I mean, I know how to do what all the stuff that we're going out there to do, to record a show and all this stuff. But I always get, I don't know, it's a new place.
Are you comfy with traveling in general? Are you comfy with flying and negotiating airports and and all that stuff?
I actually kind of like it. It's I like puzzles and challenges and things like that. So, you know, being like, oh, gate, and I have X amount of time, and you know, that generally isn't like a problem. I think it's just the looming, like, there's a thing happening and it's coming at me.
It's unavoidable.
Yeah. Not through any like amount of difficulty, but it's just a little anxiety.
Right on. In what direction is your anxiety focused? Just on the not knowing part, or the specifically traveling with someone? Like, is any of the anxiety about like, oh, I don't know, I'm going on Brushwood's dime. What does he expect?
And all that stuff. And maybe a little bit of that. I'm more worried about like the actual show.
Which show?
Night Attack.
Son. Yeah. Is that all you're worried about?
My thinking is just I want to make sure that I do good enough that like we don't lose this whole thing.
Oh, no. Okay. So first of all, understand, like, I guess I understand the anxiety of like you're rolling with a solo gig, right? You are now producing a live, you know, you're producing the official recording of a live event. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, while we do it, we'll have people periscoping and like we did last year, right?
Right.
But, you know, I think you know the basics. You know, you're going to set up a static camera. You'll have a mobile camera. You'll, plug into the board with the sound and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And I mean, the good news is, it ain't like if the recorded show sucks, it ain't like the folks at Nerdtacular are even going to care because, you know, as long as the live show was good, right?
Right.
And the live show, you know, we're going to have so much to talk about. There's so much going on, you know, there's so much electricity. You know, get ready for the 6 weeks of the arc being all about Justin Robert Young and the insanity that he's going through. You know, last year the arc was about Brian's insanity, but this year Brian's like, I don't know, losing weight, eating veggies, taking her easy.
Because Justin is doing his one man show immediately before Night Attack. Like, the schedule doesn't have any break on there.
Yeah.
And
he wants you to record that as well, right? Oh! Did that not? He.
I thought, spoiler alert.
No, I think that was for the Dragon Con for the wedding.
Okay. Oh, that's right. Okay. Well, I'm sure he wants some kind of recording of the live show. We'll see about it. But that
you now that
ain't on your shoulders. Sure. I'm not handing that to you. Okay.
Furiously texting on one hand.
No. Sorry. Don't worry about it. So here's what you can expect from Nerdtacular. is. The good news is it's like Fight Club. You choose your own level of involvement, right? Mm-hmm. Like, there have been conventions. For example, last year at Nerdtacular, I was less participatory because my head was all in shooting the hacking the system, and I was freaking out.
Right.
You know, pretty much I would spend an hour or two in the room just chilling, and then it's like, all right, it's this panel that I'm on. Get already psyched up. Go, hey, look at that. Everything's fun. I'm going to go back to the room and be real quiet and listen to an audiobook for a little bit.
Sure.
You know, so if that's what you need, then that could be your experience, you know, because the only thing you have to do is produce the Night Attack stuff.
Right.
But along the way, you're going to see so many freaking other opportunities. Once you're there, you'll discover you got a lot more free time than you think, and you can choose to watch panels and you know, be involved. You'll end up meeting so many people from Chat Realm. To be honest, here's what I suspect the biggest surprise for you will be is the fact that you will suddenly feel like a celebrity. I don't know how often that happens to you, but when you are there, think about this. There's 800 people there, and a third of them will look at your face and say, like, hey, are you Neshcom? And want to say hi. And say, oh, she should see the twinkle in his eye now.
Maybe just a little bit. Yeah, I mean, definitely. Like, Nerdtacular, the experience, like, looking at the schedule seems, like, way tame as far as, like, the amount of panels that are going to be there. And I'm definitely, like, I know there are a number of people who have already, you know, through Twitch or through Twitter that are like, hey, I'm going to be at Nerdtacular, and I'm going to be at Nerdtacular. So, like, we'll brofist or whatever, we'll kappa, we'll do whatever kappa is.
Wait, what is kappa?
It's a Twitch emote.
What is it?
Everybody's like, kappa. It's like a...
Oh, the actual symbol, kappa?
No. Yeah. It's an emote. It's
Oh, got it. It's a guy, kappa.
It's
got it.
Guy.
Got it. It's like the man emote. Yeah, they made one for me. But
Spike Attack.
And now it didn't go over to Twitch.
Nope.
Mm.
Well, now most of the... I mean, there a couple of Universal emotes, but most of them are like subscriber emotes.
Yeah.
So if people subscribe to your channel, they get a specific emotes. Set of emotes.
Very clever.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm definitely looking forward to, you know, just getting to whatever the like conversation, like I'm looking forward to meeting more chat realm people in person, because I know when I first went to South by Southwest last year, that was a really awesome time to be like, hey, you exist in Meatspace as well, and we are no longer hundreds and thousands of miles separated.
Well, and you also, every time you see that name, mm-hmm. you know, you have a real person in your mind. Yeah. Like, mm-hmm. you know, having Ben Franklin in the chat right now, mm-hmm. you know, we've met several times, including, I think, most recently in St. Louis, he came out at my stage show. And it was so awesome having 14 people and being able to put faces to names to where, you know, they're all real people. I mean, of course, they're all real people. But, you know, that Dunbar's number, you could only handle, you know,
so many
friends. You know, you think about your tribe. It's supposed to be 150, but we're all like the Borg. We're artificially enhanced to be able to have thousands of friends.
Yeah.
But it's fantastic.
Yeah. So that's a Nerdtacular. Did you go to Nerdtacular before, Brent?
Wait, real quick. This is an important question. Waffleophagus wants to know if it's Meatspace, M-E-E-T, or Meatspace, M-E-A-T.
Oh.
And the first time I saw it was in print in mm-hmm. Cryptonomicon, where they gave Meatspace coordinates. And for all I know, that may be the first time it showed up.
Oh, I always think of it as M-E-A-T.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. Where your meat is. Yeah.
Flesh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know.
IRL.
IRL, yeah.
I went to I hit the con circuit in 2013.
Year?
I don't think I did any of them last year.
Okay.
But yeah, so this is your first con, is that correct?
I've been to conventions before, but this is my first
Chat Realm Con. Gotcha.
And then we've got Nerdtacular almost a month after. Mm-hmm. After Nerdtacular, so
Dragon Con.
I'm sorry, did I say
yeah?
So it'll
and you're coming to that one too, and mm-hmm. that one you'll have the responsibility to shoot. And that one's going to be, I'll tell you what, mm-hmm. Nerdtacular is a great little training ground, little practice sesh.
Sure,
we're going to show up on time. We're going to leave on time. It's mm-hmm. going to be easy. We're going to be there
in
for the
out.
Whole thing.
Yeah.
We really only have the one show. Dragon Con's going to be the reverse.
Yeah,
because I've got the Friday night thing. You, me, and Bonnie are going to be leaving at 6 in the morning. We're going to swoop in the day of, still having to figure out what the hotel situation is. Mm. We're going to run right in. We're going to do the wedding that night.
Yeah.
Boom.
Wait, the wedding is Friday night?
No, Saturday night.
Saturday?
But,
okay.
But we leave Saturday morning. We arrive Saturday close to noon. And then we're going to swoop right in. And then it's like, I'm going to be running on panels. And then and you're going to be setting up so that, you know, getting ready so you can record the wedding and everything. And good luck with that.
Yep. Good luck.
Have fun.
It'll be fine. This is a challenge. This is just a puzzle to figure out.
Do you have your day pass and everything for that?
Nope.
You might want to
work that out. I know. I don't even have my Nerdtacular ticket yet.
I mean, the good news is you can always be Penelope Brushwood for as close as they feel like looking at your
Penne.
People call me Pen for short.
Yeah. I'm actually Penne Brushwood, P-E-N-N-E.
It's actually pronounced Penelope.
Yeah, Dragon Con was a... you get hardened through the crucible of Dragon Con.
Oof.
That was one of the most potentially dangerous anxiety situations for me.
Because you aren't feeling cons at all.
No.
You are not. That's the opposite of what
he's not feeling
likes.
The 7-Eleven. He's definitely not feeling the cons.
I was stressed out going to the post office. I was like, ugh. But yeah, Nerdtacular is fun. You definitely get a much more higher density of cool chat realm people, which is nice. Although I have some similar issues with both, but yeah.
I'll tell you what, though. Having said all that, you know, I suspect that you will really, really dig just seeing the human ebb and flow of insanity, the postmodernist, you know, dream that is, you know, the evenings in Dragon Con. I suspect I suspect once you're out of work mode, you're gonna find yourself drinking, what is it, the rum and coke?
Rum
is what
coke.
You like.
Cuba Libre.
And you're gonna, I'm gonna see the slow grin spread across your face as you say, I could get into this. I'm stoked.
Yeah, I think definitely it's definitely going to be just like getting out of a work mode situation. And even thinking about it, like the worst case scenario probably won't be so bad and something that could be fixed. Like there, like I can't imagine a catastrophe so bad. I'm not going to finish that thought. I'm not going to finish the thought because it's obviously like halfway to jinxing myself.
Say Voldemort's name. Go for it. I dare you.
But I feel confident in our ability to problem solve. You know, that is like in college, that was a very early thing you learn, is that most of your time is troubleshooting, not creating. So I'm confident, and I think we're going to do a great show.
Plus also just one more thing to rely on. Not that you need to have this be your official starting plan, but understand you are surrounded by hundreds of chat realmers, each of which who are going to ask, what can I do to help?
Yeah.
It's like, and that's amazing thing.
There's already been people asking how they can help.
And for the record, they're not joking. For them, they're like, I want to be a part. It's just like, it's just like writing the doc and all that stuff. It's fun for them to be part of the show. And so, you know, if you trust them, give them a job.
Yeah. I believe that it will happen for a number of people.
Yeah.
Just please do this thing or, you know, you know, we're all going to kill it. We're going to vanquish the dragon. Come out the other side with a really great show.
Yeah. Right on.
Next topic. So Brian, you finally joined Slack.
Yeah.
Put your slacks on.
I knew this was coming.
I have to say, I'm really, I don't want to sound condescending, but I'm very proud that you have embraced Slack.
Well, and it occurs to me, this is how old people get old, is they don't do the new thing because they don't have to, because they can just sit there and, Slack?
Oh, Facebook. No, Facebook is open.
Because old people can get away with saying, man, I'm not going to do that thing, then they end up getting ossified and dumb. And for me, the thing was, I didn't want one more thing to sign into each morning, and I work on a shared computer, so it would be me having to re-sign into it. But the moment it was like there's an app, I was like, oh great! And then and I know that it's so easy for you guys to ping me, and I'm like, oh yeah, thing, and oh preview, oh that looks great, and all this stuff. So I see. I suspect that the more people on your team, the more awesome Slack becomes at all times.
Yeah. Especially if you are like, because like we have a lot of people on the chat realm team, the chat room,
the
ops
club
team
stuff.
And so it's kind of like a wave. It depends on like, you know, what you're working on, how active it is. But it's really nice for organizing stuff. I needed T2 for something the other day, and I tried to get him on chat and he wasn't there. And I opened up Slack and like, what I was looking for was literally right there. We had talked about this thing on Slack, and so all of that information was right there, and it's easy to search. It's really a more active team, like a more like office setting where like team communiques are
It strikes me as kind of like we rely on the IRC chat room, but whenever it comes to posting and stuff, you got to put it on a hosting service or whatever. But it's like all that is built into Slack, you know, whether it's a picture you're dragging over or a link or, you know, throwing files around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you still got some channels to join in our stuff, because we have specific channels for like scam school stuff and stuff.
See,
and rogue stuff. And
this is do so because I respect the Brantness of Brant, but the Brianness of Brian is like, man, there's five of us. Let's just all stay in the same room all the time.
Right.
And then Brant's like, no, there are different projects. They need different places.
Yeah. Yeah. You can set it up pretty smartly. Like you know, sometimes you can join a channel and have it be like, oh, if anybody posts anything, I get like a push notification, so that way you can be up to the date, up to the minute. But you could also do like a soft notification where it's like it shows up as you have a notification, but it doesn't do a push for it.
Okay.
Or you can set it if someone mentions you.
Yeah, it could just be silent unless somebody says, hey, Brian.
Poke, like join this conversation. And that's the other nice thing. Unlike our IRC, if I come in halfway through the conversation, I only get to know like the last couple of lines, whereas Slack, I show up and it's just like, yeah, you could scroll back and get the entire, you know, group conversation that had been happening when you weren't there.
Yeah. And the ability to search that stuff, to favorite individual messages, and the file uploading capabilities, like,
it's pretty nice.
It's crazy. Like, that's by the same people who made Flickr, and both of those were supposed to be systems for like a video game.
Like, no kidding.
They were like, they were working on an MMO, I think. And this, whatever the engine for Slack was, they were like, hey, let's just do this because this is amazing. It's really cool.
I feel like it's a really important step for all of us, because I don't think I'm alone in believing that there's maybe been a little bit of a communication issue over time. And I feel like on some level that sort of stems from, you know,
not having a unified place.
Well, inherently we are like, Brian is the company and we are all independently contracted. We are not collectively a company.
Right.
And, you know, companies have built-in infrastructures and they have systems in place for
Outlook
communication
and
all that stuff.
Yeah.
And we don't really have that. And up until 2 years ago or whatever, we didn't really need that because it was just Brian and one other person. It was Brian and John. And even then, like, there were half of the branches that we have now. You know, it was like, oh, I need to talk to you about doing the touring stage show. And that's kind of it. But now we have scam stuff, and then we have scam school, and then we have whatever else. Right. And we have enough people now that, you know, like, communication is so important. And I think a lot
and
of...
And it can't just live in text messages and emails forever because... That's a lot of different media for information to live.
Yeah.
Well, and the I don't know, the exciting weird thing is that we are in that very awkward transition phase where it's like we're realizing that, you know, I'm only going to get dumber from here is what I'm trying to say, and I'm only need to be wrangled more from here. If, you know, for example, let's say we sell another TV project or whatever, or we decide to launch another, project, or let's say we decide we actually do end up buying a puppy and having a clubhouse or whatever. Mm-hmm. We're at that point where we need to develop good communication hygiene practices now so that people aren't clawing their eyes out, 2 years
from now. When the
stakes
are higher, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And I think Slack's a good part of it. I think that, I need somebody to, and I've talked to both of you guys about this, part-time come in and wrangle my inbox and make sure that I see the important stuff, and more importantly, handle my calendar so that I'm just swinging from thing to thing to thing. Yeah. And that more importantly, not so much for the start times, but for the end times. So it's like, and my 2 hours on email are done. There's literally nothing else I'm going to do for the rest of the day. And I don't know. I'm excited about putting that in because I do feel like I've been giving you guys short shrift because I can't keep everything in my head long enough for everything. And if we could do more stuff like Slack, I think you guys will want to kill me less, which would be good.
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
And also they have fun in GIFs.
The little loading messages also. The GIFs are great. Yeah, you made some really great custom like emotes.
Yeah, I wish they were bigger.
They're so small.
They're really small.
They're tiny.
And actually the
it's a miracle that you can read some of the words on them.
Yeah, and they store them in a readable size, more or less, but they just surface up really small in the app.
I expect that they'll probably do some sort of like emoji size function.
I think they're pushing out a big update. I was hoping that would be in it, but I don't know.
Slack 0.0?
Yeah. Anyway, next, let's jump over to the next Brian one.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
while we got him.
Get this dude out of here.
So you were on a television show recently.
Television.
It's an adorable old school media.
On the inner tubes.
Yeah, man. The Penn and Teller thing. Funny. It's funny because when I told one of our friends that I was going to do it, he was like, he was very confused. He was like, why are you going to go be on a competition reality show? That seems beneath you. You host your own series on National Geographic. And I was like, because it's Penn and Teller and because it sounds fun and because they're going to let me do one of my favorite bits and because I genuinely don't give a rat's ass about whether or not I fool them. And, you know, I didn't know how everything would be smoothed out in the edit. I didn't know, you know, how, what angles they got and didn't get. And it was a real delight to have so many people say such nice things and for the video version of it to really apparently by, you know, scam school standards to really blow up. You
it's
know?
Erupting. Mm-hmm. Like in terms of likes, in terms of comments, in terms of views.
Yeah.
It's... You know, and it's like clear, like that it is a big moment.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's also you know, you're only as good as your last album, right? And it's like, you know, after the high of hacking the system, and then there was another high as it went international release over the last couple of months, and you know, this influx of people saying nice things about your project or whatever. You know, then it's like, and now we're in that phase where it's like, okay, what's the next thing we're going to start pitching? What's the next, you know, what does the next 5 years look like as we, you know, hopefully continue to expand and you know, eventually get our own place for the business and become, you know, a grown up, you know, miniature wannabe Rooster Teeth. You know, it was cool to have some work that I did in April pop up and to be so well received and to like, you know, without giving details, it's like, you know, I'm talking to some TV companies and it sure is great to be able to talk to TV production companies. And
I was on TV and look how big this thing went.
Well, or, you know, to have it be literally, you know, 3-5 days ago that it's like, oh yeah, that thing happened. And they're like, wow, or whatever. But I don't know. It was fun and good. But I'll tell you what, man, my favorite thing was the way you handled the behind the scam, talking about that experience and cutting together. I'm glad we got to tell that little bit of the behind the scenes story. And I want to increasingly give more chat realm programming some love from the Scam School channel. Like, I'm not saying open up the floodgates and let all the normies in, but I'm going to say maybe crack the door open and let them know that there's another party happening over here if they want to get freaky with us.
And we did that. We also did that again this month earlier with talking about DiamondClub.tv during Behind the Scam.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right. I meant to do even more of that, but the Fool Us thing blew up.
Right.
Oh, by the way, that headroom thing, now that you said that, Brant, I totally like watching Mr. Robot. I don't think half the heads make it to the halfway point.
Oh, really?
Like there are some insane, like I normally don't pay attention to that, but like their angles are insane. When they have a shot, reverse shot, the characters are in the lower left-hand corner looking the wrong way from each other. and then they, it's so, and I know that that's meant to make you off kilter. Anyway, it's, yeah, I noticed that now.
That's funny. But yeah, like when, you know, I think it was the last, a very important meeting that we did, was when you had that briefcase full of money. I remember around then, like you kind of had those mixed feelings of like, I could tell you deep down, like, I want to do this, but am I going to be represented right? Like, is it going to be good for me? All of these things. And I think it ended up coming out really well, and I'm glad you jumped on that.
Yeah, and to be honest, weirdly, I'm glad, like, we recorded a bunch of me, you know, talking about Scam School and such, but instead they edited my intro package to be a love letter to Penn and Teller, which I think was the right call, because then, you know, when the trick was over, it was a love letter from Penn and Teller to Brian, and it's like, I mean, I mean, if I have to choose between a plastic trophy that says F you and between having
and them, you already have two of those.
Yeah, exactly. but between, you know, having Pentatello say what they did, I mean, I'm really, really proud of how it came out, especially because I essentially, you know, in the span of that 4 weeks between saying, sure, I'll figure out a way to take this card trick and somehow make it a dollar bill trick, mm-hmm. and then having to figure out the method to do it, and you guys know that it was extremely tedious to do, yeah. and to have it work and everything, it's like I was very, very happy with that, mm-hmm. and I'm glad that on the record, I'm glad that both the episode there, but more importantly, a little bit of that telling the true story of the behind the scenes of the behind the scam came out to you.
Yeah. You gonna invoice them that $30 that they took?
It was $100.
Oh, was it $100?
$99. We burned the one. That was my fault. The one I burned. somebody pointed out. Like to me, the whole thing I love about that trick is the fact it's so inappropriate to grab a random volunteer from the audience and force feed them the burned remains of a dollar bill because they're filthy to begin with, right?
Yeah.
But then somebody specifically remembered the unrelated story that I had told before about, like, that was your sweat dollar.
Oh, no!
I was like, oh, yeah, that does put a wrinkle on it.
Okay, so the sweat dollar story, in short, was that you would put them on your flesh while you went to go do cardio.
Yeah, I would basically wipe stuff around on them so that it would be weathered the way a normal bill would.
Did you do that with all of them? Oh my God, Brian.
I mean, is that any more filthy than a million hands touching it?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. There's a DNA element.
Would you rather lick 10,000 strangers' hands or just Brian's back sweat?
All right, yeah, Bryce.
Let's not answer that.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Before the show, Brian, you mentioned that you had a topic you wanted to talk about. Shirts.
Oh, yeah. No,
get
I
shirts,
guess
dog.
We should save that idea for Night Attack, I realized. But I should talk to you about shirts.
I thought we had someone who was doing
well, yes, yeah, right. But the problem is we don't have any of those, and we didn't order any in bulk or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I have an idea.
I thought he was doing that.
Maybe not.
No, I think Bryce.
I think he just did a Teespring thing, right? And it wasn't until you know we're right up on Nerdtacular that Justin and I realized, like, crap. People really like coming up afterwards and getting a thing that to get signed afterwards.
Sure.
And I have an idea on how to handle that, and we'll share it on Night Attack.
Okay, so that's the radio tease for Night Attack on Tuesday, diamondclub.tv.
but I do need to talk to you about it because it involves us taking some stuff.
Okay, cool. Speaking of shirts, before we move on to another topic, unless this is that exact topic, there was the Classic Game Festival here in Austin over the weekend. It's like Texas's biggest retro game. They get like half of the Palmer Center, and they had bands, and Richard Garriott was there.
Oh, right on.
Bernie Klein was there.
Yeah.
And I represented the BJC, wore my Hearth and Oats shirt.
Oh, good, good.
At least five different people stopped me.
Wait, just to ask what
just
it was?
Like, oh, that's so great. It's so subtle. It's a perfect idea.
That's hilarious. That is awesome.
Yeah. Shopkeepers, people at selling stuff were like, that's a good shirt.
Dude, someone it's stopped. Great to have someone, a winner like that. That's awesome.
Someone stopped, turned around, and took a photo of me.
Ah! Dude, if you're this excited about someone liking your shirt, you're gonna explode with joygasm at friggin' Nerdtacular. It's gonna be amazing.
Yeah. So, well met.
Hello. I had a topic from last month.
Oh yeah.
And it was just our first episode. We kind of talked about food a little bit because both Bryce, John, and myself are weird with food in our own ways.
Mm-hmm.
Brian, you eat a lot of beef jerky.
Used to.
Yeah, because he's on his faux vegan diet right now.
What's that all about? Like, I don't get it.
One day I realized
for someone so health conscious, it's like terrible for you, isn't it?
I mean, no, it's extremely low calorie, extremely high protein,
and sodium, extremely, I would imagine.
And sodium could be a problem if you have high blood pressure, which I don't. Mm-hmm. Apparently not everyone, there are people for whom sodium affects their blood pressure and there are people for whom it doesn't. And I appear to be the latter. Mm-hmm. So I'm not worried about that.
Brag about it.
It's filling and it's only 210 calories for an entire package of it. Mm-hmm. So it's like to me, it was a math thing, but this is back when I was just figuring calories was king. Which worked for a while, but now, now I'm on this nutty new thing, which, by the way, I changed our travel plans and I rented a car just because I realized that if we took the shuttle to Nerdtacular, we would not be able to stop and have me buy a mountain of vegetables for the room.
Sure, yeah. So room vegetables.
Now I'm that weirdo.
Room vegetables.
That's ain't nothing wrong with room veggies.
Yeah, get some
V8s.
Sure. As long as I can get some bananas or some
Pop-Tarts. Can we throw some fruits in there? That's cool.
Oh, yeah. Man. Bring me some.
From Salt Lake.
Just mail them.
Great.
Priority. For me, I'm such a weird. We have concerns. Just had an episode about picky eaters and food and stuff, and somebody tried to like classify picky eaters into like you're this kind of picky, you're this kind of picky. I ended up classifying as most of the types.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Is there a test you could take online?
No, it's just like broad. Like you're a sensory eater or whatever, and like smells are a big deal or
mouth
whatever.
Feel.
Like for me, I mean, my weird thing is, and everyone rolls their eyes, is fruits. Like the only fruits I can handle are really oranges, lemons, limes. That's the citrus. Because I like the acidity, and even oranges are almost too sweet for me. Everything else is just too powerful. It's just too much. I hate it. Strawberries. I'm like,
Waffleophilus asks apples.
Those
aren't very sweet at all. Generally, if you get a certain kind.
I mean, that's on the high end of the sweet scale. Like, I won't have I eat an apple or I eat a piece of an apple on the stage show because that's what made sense. But I would say, in the last 20 years, I've never thought I'm hungry. I'd like an apple. Although I have done that with a banana here and there. A banana is cool.
Hell yeah, bananas are great. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like up there in the top three fruits.
Oh, for sure. And right. Like, dog. Banana orange juice.
Banana orange juice.
It's so good.
Dude, Bonnie got trained. She started to buy that on her own. She saw that in the fridge enough. Yeah, she's like, keep it coming.
It's really good. I'm super big on mostly all fruits. But yeah, beef jerky, it's like seafood. Like there's no way I could get past the smell.
Oh shit! Well, now I feel bad for all the times I ate it in the car. Yeah,
it's fine.
It's bygones.
I was like, it's probably better that he eats something than that I dislike the smell. right. But I mean, there are things like bacon. If somebody cooks bacon in the house, I have to leave the house.
Really?
Because it just like the smell overwhelms me in a bad way.
That's been one of the craziest things about this nutty diet is the resetting of my taste buds. When I was at Justin's bachelor party, I ate while I was hanging out there like three heads of lettuce because that's all they had. They were for the hamburgers. I swiped them and I was like, and meanwhile, they brought in a pizza and I would never have believed this was possible. But I found myself smelling the smell of a fresh pizza coming into the room and just, you know, being all like, eh. You know, it just smelled like, you know, I don't know, kind of rancid, greasy, overdone.
Yeah, I guess if there's like a lot of grease, you can tell like, oh, that's gonna be
grease
pizza
is the worst.
Yeah,
like that's the only bad pizza is a grease pizza.
It's really greasy. Yeah.
But what happens is like, you know, now when I, and again, I'm only 3 weeks into this and you know, by the time this comes out or by the, you know, in another month, I may be totally off this, but for now, like I can eat a salad and be all like, ooh, this one has a radish in, this bite has a radish in it. And then, you know, I'm like, oh my gosh, a cucumber and a bell pepper. I wonder what this will taste like. You know, like that subtlety that was normally lost to me because I was pummeling it with, you know, the likes of beef jerky and Diet Cokes or whatever. I mean, still do Diet Cokes. But, you know, now I find that subtlety with vegetables much more interesting.
Hmm. Yeah, vegetables are great.
I feel, have you had sushi? Like, I feel like sushi be a thing.
Love sushi.
That you might experience a new spectrum of flavor in sushi now that you are on this, or your diet, your taste buds have reset because it's very subtler.
Well, once I
can you eat fish?
Not in the first 6 weeks. First 6 weeks is everything just hardcore crazy. But then you lose the bulk of the weight you're going to lose in that first 6 weeks, and then after that you can start reintroducing a little bit of as meat. Appropriate meats. Fish is. Really, just in general, I'm just going to have to get used to the idea of not doing hamburgers anymore or whatever. But meanwhile, rare and appropriate, okay. But I'll tell you this much, 3 weeks, I've been fighting the same 15 pounds for 5 years. And in 3 weeks, I'm 10, 11 pounds down. Yeah. I've got like 4 to go. It's insane.
There you go. Mm. Veganism. Mm.
It's great.
The perfect diet.
No. Well, they call it,
be fit to live? Neutrino vision.
No. God damn it. Somebody in the chat will get it for me.
It's sure.
Nutrient is a, it's not an ism. It's a nutritarian. Something like that.
Nutritarian.
Like, yeah, being a nutritarian, where it's like the defining characteristic is stuff that's high in nutrients and calorie liberty. Poor. So as long as it's calorie
Neutrogena.
Poor.
Neutrogena, NutraSweet, no meativism.
God damn it.
On the inverse of that,
only lard.
Close. Right before we started filming, I ran out to the post office, and one of the things that I picked up was a scale, because I've never owned a scale before. Mm. So when I lived here, it was pretty dope because there's a scale in the garage for weighing scam stuff things.
Yeah.
So sometimes I just go down there and be like, "Oh, I haven't weighed myself in a year. Let's see where I'm at." Ooh. And I weighed more than I've ever weighed before.
Did that bother you, or
I was like, "Is this going to be a problem?" And then I thought, probably not.
Well, how old are you now?
23.
Okay, you got a couple more years to really before you like. I think it was around 26 that I was like, "Guess it's time to be a diet cook man from now on."
Right. Yeah, I was at a hefty 127. So.
Dude, I remember those days.
It dropped down after that. Once I regulated. Well, also.
Oh,
it
was, good. You yeah. came down from 127.
And it was also kind of rough because when I lived here, I basically ate fast food every day.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want to buy groceries and then like come back with groceries. That seemed really weird to me. So now I'm starting to regulate a little bit more and ease off the fast food.
I haven't weighed myself. I hesitate to say years, but a very long time. I have a lot of self confidence in my body image, and
I'm good. Me too.
he
said almost with a straight face.
But it's weird because some part of me is like, well, you can find out the number pretty easily.
We could do it live on the air.
Just fine.
We could do it right now. We could have a life-changing moment.
Christ. Exclusive. Pay-per-view.
Pay-per-view special.
Oh, Jesus. Body positivity.
Yeah, man.
Bodytivity.
I'm pretty happy about myself.
Yeah. You're feeling yourself. You're feeling yourself.
Every day.
I don't think that's what Beyonce was going for, but okay.
Oh, okay.
Man, are there any other Brian topics? Because I may be need go. To bolt now.
Let's run through this real quick. I think we've only got one or two.
Two.
First, real quick, can you give us a pup date?
Pup date. Here's the pup date is I'm going to go look at a shared puppy. We were supposed to do it on Wednesday, but it turns out, and I kind of like this idea, there's someone in the neighborhood who has a business that what she wants, she doesn't really care about any of the space in it. But she does care about having signage so that she is established, you know, so it's not a home-based business. Mm-hmm. It's a place for, you know, everyone to see, oh, there's that sign, there's that company, that's who I call or whatever. Oh. She won't ever be taking clients there. She's got some employees that
she wants you to be the nail salon from Better Call Saul.
That's exactly what I was thinking of, and that's why I'm so okay with it. And because I don't know if I should say what it is, but I know, like, I've been to Penn & Teller's warehouse, and I know that the name out front.
Oh, they have a disguised name.
Right? Yes, correct.
And the letterhead and all that stuff is fake too, right?
Correct. Yeah. Wait.
Interesting. You've told me this.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Yeah.
And no. So, this is everyone knows.
I was like, wait. Do you know? Is this a known thing? Can I talk about it?
No.
Yeah. So I was like, I'd be okay with having a fake front up there, and then and it's not a lot of space. I think we'd only have like 800 or 1,000 square feet to work with. But what
should probably be in. Plenty.
Well, maybe.
Not the scam stuff would need more space.
Well, yeah. Well, actually, I think the scam stuff is what would be there, and I think it would just free up the garage, and then we could actually make a downstairs a warehouse studio in the garage or whatever for live shoots on that stuff, and then that way because you guys are only here one or two days a week, whereas John is in this house every single day.
Right.
So it's like, and if he was there doing scam stuff, and I just made the habit of, you know, doing office hours for 2 or 3 hours a day with him, then that would compartmentalize that, and then you know, each time there's we do something here, it's a welcome guest thing. Hmm. So I don't know. We'll see. That seems to me like a middle step we can take right away.
Oh, while something else happens.
Like the ultimate goal, like if we had the money, and we don't, but if we had the money, it would be rad to get a couple acres and build two separate buildings. You know, one is the house that Brian lives in, and the other is a firehouse with two stories that has, you know, part scam stuff and part studio and all that stuff.
Yeah. A compound.
Really on this firehouse thing.
Whoa, dude, once I saw it, and there will be a damn pole in this for damn sure. That is happening. Well, what I would love is a multi-story building with like
the observation deck.
Yeah,
that's your thing, right?
Because we talked about that, but again, money's not there today, but you know, in a year or two, it could be.
Yeah,
and then that was, you know, somebody was rolling their eyes that, you know, everyone's independent contractors right now, but again, that's a function because, you know, I was a self-employed single person up until really like what, last year, two years,
right?
We really have started the scam stuff, empire and the TV thing. So, I mean, certainly it's the plan is, you know, like I've told you guys, you know, I want to throw everyone raises as fast as we can to keep everyone happy.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have a fun bit every month where we bring to the table the latest pup dates that we've all heard because they're all different.
Oh yeah. They're all insane. They're all nuts. Yeah.
But that sounds like a fun idea for now. Let's see where that takes it. Yeah. And then our last topic for you, Brian, is, and you touched on it briefly earlier, you were at Justin's bachelor party just recently.
Yeah.
A couple days ago.
Very hush-hush. How was that?
A little bit of periscoping.
I mean, we periscoped. I don't think it was totally hush-hush, mainly because Justin just didn't want to eat, you know. Everyone kept asking him what the rules were, who were invited, or all that. And it's like, he was like, you know what, the greatest gift you could give me is not telling me anything and not making me the focus.
Away.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. He's like, you know, what I want the most is to black out these days and not think about it. I literally don't care what we do. I literally don't care. You know, make this your problem would be the best thing you could possibly do.
Which is kind of like the objective with a bachelor party, right? Is that the best man sets up something.
Yeah, yeah. But of course, you know, everyone calls Justin. And they're like, oh, is it okay? Can we bring girls? You know, and so it was supposed to be a one-day affair. And I'm sure we'll talk about this on Night Attack. But it was awesome to it was funny because I did the first night of his bachelor party one night and then didn't go to bed. Or tried to go to bed, but didn't. And then flew in, got a couple hours nap, and then went to one of my best friends from college's weddings where I was in the wedding party. Wow. And so it was just, everything was insane. But it was so cool meeting all these other copies of Justin, you know, the people, because he tells all these stories from his crazy college days, and they're all Justin. All of they're six Justins.
Yeah. Justin is a commodity now.
Yes, exactly.
If you distill it, yeah,
exactly. It was very, very cool, and I think I'll save most of the stories for Night Attack on that. Gotcha. But it was a great experience.
So
cool.
Check that out, Night Attack on Tuesday night.
It's a little show you might have heard of.
Yeah.
Yep.
Last thing.
Yes.
You are crazy for not staying to the end of the credits at the end of movies.
Okay. Fucking burn me. Burn me so many times. Because here's the problem. This is these are the cackling hyenas, you the got, jackals.
Like, even if
these
there's are, nothing out after that.
No, no. I was a chump. Uh-huh. I was a sucker that the jackals of Justin and Andrew cackled at me for being such a sucker as to stick around for the ending of all of the after credits of Ultron, like I was the dumbest person on earth. And then these assholes turn around and give the same hyena laughs when I don't stick around for the credits at the end of Ant-Man. Sure. And there's like, no, don't you know, bro? You're supposed to check the invites and then blah, blah, blah. So you can see some what amounts to an advertisement for another thing. True. No, I'm done. I'm out. I made the rule on weird things. I see a key grip. I'm out of that theater. That's the rule.
MediaStinger.com.
I agree with you, Brian.
Look, I don't care. If your game is you want to train me over the years to stick around for after the credits, that's great. Let's then do that.
It was kind of shitty that you want to train like, me no,
that's over right. now. Then that's fine. But don't be. Look. I mean, you get a house train a puppy. Mm-hmm. You be consistent in your rules, and he will. You know, whatever. I'm gonna piss on your carpet. I don't give a rat's ass. Half the time you're gonna show me something. Half the time you won't. How about all the time? How about all the time I take a dump on the carpet and leave? How do you like that?
I mean, I guess it's not like it's not that anybody is berating you. I know I called you stupid.
It's not that anybody's berating you. It is exactly like two MFers berate me constantly. I mean, this is not a universal thing. This is an Andrew and Justin thing because they needle me mercilessly for whether I did or didn't do the right thing. Screw that. I'm done. I'm out. I'll never stick around.
They care. They want you to not miss that, part of it is.
I mean, unless I try to see it, in which case I'm a hilarious sucker and who needs to be taught.
If you stay around, you don't need to tell people that there's nothing after it. You got to tell people that you waited and there was nothing. You got to tell people you fell on your
cozy
your
up.
Sounds like a little bit of victim
blaming. In your hyena clubhouse where you all can and laugh at the suckers who don't preview and set out an agenda. You know what? Here's what I'll do. I'll hire a cruise planner to plan my evening.
Sure.
And she'll ask in advance and she'll say, you know, I've heard that there's a delightful vignette at the end after the credits. Would you like to participate in that? And then I'll pay someone to decide on that shit for me. But I'm done gambling like a sucker.
So there's an entire website here that spoiler free tells you if there's stuff after or during the credits.
Why do we have to go to a website?
Oh my god, homework before seeing a movie? Oh, that sounds like so much fun.
Fuck you a little bit.
Oh my god.
You care so much to be mad about this, but there's a solution right here on your
All I have to do is homework before each time. That's
you can
great.
Do it during the credits. And then walk out if there's nothing.
No, that sounds like a great thing to do while my children are running around in circles. Like, hold on, kids. Don't run to the bathroom yet. Daddy's looking up whether or not we can stick around for
just
a minute
don't have kids.
I mean, that's the simple thing. This is all crap you have the luxury of caring about when you're not taking your kids to the movies.
Well, I mean, we didn't mean to start a witch hunt, but just...
I feel like most... Most films that have post-credit tags end up being like of the Marvel variety, and I'm kind of done with all of them. So, whatever. I think it's kind of dumb. And usually it's like, I mean, when they first started doing it, there was a novelty to it, like, oh, it's a little secret thing. But now it's just like, whatever, man. Whatever.
Yeah. I don't care. Keep in mind, by the way, this goes all the way back to the first Avengers, where, again, we have been trained that credits go, and then you get a teaser for the Avengers. All of those things were teasing the Avengers. We're finally at the Avengers, credits roll, and then after the credits, there's Thanos. And it's like, oh my gosh, that's the big thing, is now they're teasing this thing with Thanos. And so I leave the theater, you know, and I'm like, they did me the courtesy of showing it before I had to see the stupid key grip. This is a great solution. Good job. And then fucking jackals, the hyenas. Oh, sucker Brian, you didn't stick around for the second one. Didn't you hear? Didn't you do your homework? There's two this time.
No, I agree with you on all of this.
Jackals, like, I'm done.
It's bullshit.
Done. I don't take orders from hyenas, motherfuckers. I'm done. I'm done.
You just need better friends, Brian.
Maybe.
All right. With that, I say all that with complete love. Yeah. I would hug each and every one of you, but I got to go watch Mr. Robot.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for joining
us. Okay, guys. Thanks so much.
Bye.
Now we can get down to the real Brant rants.
Yeah. Hashtag Brant rants. We have a couple more topics here. I'd like to say Gigi.
Team China.
Team China.
Represent.
Rocket League. You know what?
China Curly don't care.
Drew. So we were playing Rocket League. If you don't know, it's
soccer with cars with rockets on the back.
Yeah.
It's great.
It's great. Fantastic. We had a little skirmish, Team DCTV and Team Drunk Kids Gaming.
Mm-hmm.
And it ended up being like 2-3. Like, right, they kind of just beat us out in the second half.
Mm-hmm.
Or in the second half of a set, whatever, tennis, whatever. The day after, Drew tweeted at me. He said, sorry for murdering your face in Rocket League last night. What the fuck? Like, no. You didn't have to do that, because I had already forgotten I'd got my ass whooped. And like, Drew specifically had spent a lot of the night like trying to blow me up specifically. Is this what esports is?
I think that is partially esports. Yeah. Yes.
I mean, I know we were talking trash. We talked our own amount of trash.
Hell yeah.
Right?
Team China don't take shit from
we don't
no
care.
One.
Right.
Right.
But I don't know. It wasn't like we got shut out. It wasn't like it was 5-0.
Right.
You know, we put up a good match.
Yeah. And they're just lucky that I took it easy. Because you saw before and after. I was pretty much killing it.
He had just bought the game and was playing it for basically the first time and was destroying motherfuckers online.
Right.
Like semi-pros and like...
Check the Twitch archives.
Check it. Hashtag check it. I want to wreck them. I would like to kick their asses and just try again.
Bryce, they're setting up the rivalry.
Yeah.
So that way the payoff is that much better.
Right.
Right.
Which is
great, because Team China is not the heel, surprisingly. In a surprise twist.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Like, we're the Mighty Ducks. We're gonna overcome.
We're the underdogs right now, but we're not any of the other 14 fluffer teams in this movie.
Right.
We will prevail because we are glorious, and you know, we have the strength and the power of unity behind us.
Yeah.
Team China represent.
And the turn to going to Team China was I was pretty proud of that.
Yeah, so Brant, we'd been playing this whole game, and pretty much it was me, Brant, and Tom DeGossa playing, and then Sergeant Muffin joined in a little later.
Mm.
And
I think you mean Steve Gibson, but
Right, sorry, Steve Gibson was
right.
And we were flying the U.S. of A., the Stars and Stripes.
Yeah,
like, bars and stars, but
like
Brant the whole time was flying the Chinese the flag of China.
Well, so I was flying USA, and I was like, yo guys, we gotta be patriotic. And so every game I was like, I'm flying USA, everybody fly USA. And then like the game that everybody switched over, I was like, by the way, I'm Team China.
Yeah. Wait, is that how it went down? I thought you were flying China all night.
No.
And then when we did China, you switched to the USA. Did I have that backwards?
Yeah,
maybe I did.
Yeah, I was USA for a long time.
You pulled it over on us.
Yes, I did. It was a really great turn.
This is esports.
This is esports.
This is esports.
But yeah, I'm really enjoying that game. I played a little bit of ranked matches.
Yeah, I haven't even played it since that night. But it's fun. It's fast.
Yeah.
It's not too long unless you go into overtime, and then it can take 30 minutes.
Yeah, it definitely depends on the teams. I did a little bit doubles, which is fun. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to switch up your strategy a little bit. their 4v4 matchings are kind of a mess.
Yeah, but they call that fun. Chaos mode.
Yeah,
because it's so ridiculous having eight people on the field.
Yeah,
yeah.
And I forgot who it was. Somebody was saying that they were looking into doing modifiers and stuff.
Mutators. Yeah, that was on the Beastcast, I think.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And that sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think definitely opening that up to being more of a party-ish game, like, will only make that more fun for people who are not, like, gung-ho about esports. Because I feel like at some point, if you are not in the, like, blops sort of just, like, online, man, that's where I'm at. Like, if you want, like, a party game, like, Rocket League is fun as is for a while, I bet, but without modifiers or without some sort of, you know, sugar, I think it could run dry.
Yeah, because I think if you're doing it in kind of a party setting, at some point, you know, you have this mixture of your players and they're playing, and then after a handful of matches, like, things kind of distill and separate into their layers, and then you kind of see, like, who are the players who just grab onto it and then they kind of run the field.
And roles, who you know, sticks behind, who is more aggressive. It's pretty simple in finding out those niches. So having more wild cards.
Wild card.
Will add some spice.
Yeah.
Some salt.
But yeah, that's a lot of fun. I really like that game. It's good.
Well, do you know what level you're at?
It's tough though. 13, something like that.
Oh, okay. That's,
Yeah. And then when I did ranked, like, I lost some matches and then I kind of came back, and so I'm about even with where you start on rank.
Okay. It's like
you start at 100.
It's points, right?
Yeah. You start at 100 points, and then if you lose matches, you lose points all the way down to 1.
Oh, wow.
I mean, not on your first loss, but it can go down to there. And then if you win, you regain points, and you can just go up and up and up and up.
Does it do a pretty good job of matching you with people who have similar
values? I mean,
does it show you?
It just shows you your rank.
Oh.
So it doesn't. I don't think it really reveals, like, the underlying mechanisms with the matchmaking or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But it seemed about right. I only played 5 or 6 matches of ranked.
Yeah. And were you getting a lot of disconnects? Because that was a big problem with some of that stuff.
Not really. It seems to have stabilized some since it kind of came out, because it was kind of notorious for really, really unstable servers and everything.
Well, I mean, like, people quitting. Because I feel like, I think if people quit on a certain type of match, does it, like, end the game? Like, my understanding is that there's a weird thing with, like, people quitting a match and you not getting even the brownie points for finishing a match.
Well, 1 or 2 times I have had people quit, especially in ranked stuff. One time I had somebody quit because some people had left the match and then it couldn't find us partners, so it threw in AI. And so they left, and I got points for victory by decision, you know.
Yeah.
And then there was one time I ended up getting onto a Europe server, which was real bad because my lag was bad. I forgot to swap that off, but we ended up winning anyway. But yeah, every now and then, you know, you get a little bit of lag or you get a disconnect, but it's somebody disconnecting from your game, not me myself. But it seemed to run more or less fine, although there was 1 or 2 times where my computer, like, fully locked up.
Yeah, I know. I definitely had a couple of, like, full-on crashes when we were playing DKG, just like, hey, your game stopped, man. Hey.
Well, for me, it was like I had to do a hard reset on my computer.
Really?
Yeah.
Whoa. That's rough.
And that might just be because my computer's old.
Maybe.
I don't know. I don't play PC games enough to really say.
Sure.
Yeah.
Hmm.
But it's a difficult game. Like, I've been practicing my aerial stuff a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
going into the practice sessions.
The aerial stuff seems so weird because it's like, it's a really advanced technique using the boosts to actually fly through the air.
Right, yeah.
But it's so difficult, complicated, and nuanced that the few times you would be able to do it because you have that much boost and you only have so much boost, it doesn't seem like there's any point of mastering it versus like trying to get better on timing with hitting things from the ground. Because the hitting things from the ground is like still pretty tough. And so to jump from that and do aerials at the same time seems like you can triage that pretty easily.
I mean, the aerial stuff is very, I think it's prudent to use it in moderation because it is so difficult. Mm-hmm. But there are definitely situations where I go like, this is the moment, right? There are like seven people underneath the ball right now and they're all going to jump after it. And it's like, if I can kind of hang back a little bit, get a little bit aerial and just knock that ball out before anybody can even get to it.
Yeah.
Then that gives us the advantage.
Have you pulled one off yet?
I've done a couple aerial hits, but no aerial goals or anything.
Huh.
But I've gotten some pretty sick moves.
Yeah.
From time to time.
Rad.
Yeah.
Radical. Bro.
Yep.
I've been in a weird funk the past couple days.
Just like in life?
Just in life.
Oh, okay.
Like, no, my smell, I think, is generally okay. I got a little bit of flop sweat, but that's because the lights are on. I just am in a weird... I don't know. I'm not, like, depressed or, like, bipolar. I just, like, I don't want to do anything. I just want to lay on the couch and gripe about True Detective on the internet and...
Gripe.
Yeah.
I just watched True Detective before I came over.
The new
latest episode, yeah.
The new episode was good in that it had some action, but man, that is a.
And it started incorporating some of those surrealist elements that I really liked.
Yeah, though, that required somebody to take hallucinogenic drugs.
Yeah.
Drug.
Which is the same from the first season.
I guess, but he was more like scarred. Like that was like mental damage.
From hallucinogenic drugs.
True.
Yes.
And also his were more like visually interesting.
Sure.
Hers was just like, here's a scene from your past.
I'm not saying it's better than season one.
Good.
I'm just saying I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I feel like I've talked about this before, maybe just in person and not on the actual internet, but season one was so special to me because it hit on every element of what I love. Like, it had the surrealism that I think is super interesting of, like, a Twin Peaks or something. Mm-hmm. And it had the philosophical approach of A Gods Will Be Watching or whatever. Like there was
Time's a flat circle, Brandt.
Yeah. There are some really interesting discussions that happened in my brain out of season one.
Yeah.
And then also like this season they also did and I guess incredibly minor spoilers. This season they also did kind of a time jump similar to
the first season. And it wasn't nearly as pronounced.
Right. But I kind of bought into it because it also wasn't nearly as big of a jump, right? The first season did like a 7-year jump or something, and this season did like a 6-month jump or something.
I thought it was like 2 months. Yeah, I think it was only like 2 months.
Yeah, maybe not even that much. But also it's really fun because I watched In Bruges the other day, and so it's a really young Colin Farrell, and he's like really laying on the Irish accent pretty thick in that movie, and then to like go back and forth between True Detective and this, where they're kind of similar characters but also totally different, that was a lot of fun for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this season I'm watching it and I know I'm gonna finish it. There's a sequence near the end of the episode tonight that sort of symbolize what I think is not so great about the season. There's an escape action sort of sequence, and the music it's playing is like very like 50s like noir soundtrack, like ripped out of some old movie. And that seemed so disparate to like what was happening, how it happened, why it was happening. I think they're just trying to make a really gritty noir series or season, and it's like I don't know that there's enough style or honestly enough character for it to be warranted, because so many people are just like kind of tropes, right? Like there's a lot of tropes and as personality, which I don't think is working great. Hi.
I don't know. It would be the kind of thing where I'd have to like sit down and really analyze it. I'm just having fun taking the ride, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
But yeah. Also, while we're talking about media,
sure.
The other day I watched Whiplash, and oh my god,
that movie is awesome. That's I looked that up because I wasn't sure what movie that was. It's like a 2014.
J.K. Simmons and
Miles Teller.
Dude, yeah. It is. It's basically about drumming, more or less.
Yeah.
And it's so good.
Hmm.
It's so good.
Is it on Netflix? Is that where you saw it?
No.
Somewhere else?
I may have seen it on a certain Chat Realmer's Plex server.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
The Flix.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But now I want to go buy it because it's like,
it was great.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This wasn't even on my, I had no idea that this movie came out.
Yeah. It's interesting because this had a lot of buzz for award season. And then I feel like it didn't really, I mean, the people who saw it really resonated with, and they loved it. But I feel like the discussion around the film didn't have a lot of staying power. I feel like a lot of people, like, it just kind of dropped off of discussions.
Sure.
Like, people didn't talk about it for too long. But for me, like, this is probably my favorite movie that I've seen this year, even though it came out
last year.
But yeah, like, it's just, like, the acting is so phenomenal, and the like, it's one of those movies where you watch it and you're like, I want to do something great right now. Like, I watched it and I was like, I want to drum.
Yeah.
Like, and then I had a moment of going, wait, like, I can't drum. So I guess I'll just go do something else and try to be great at it. But I cannot praise it enough.
All right. I'll check that out, especially if it's on a certain person's Plex.
Yeah. Hot tips.
That's great. Yeah, I
Must watch.
Hashtag.
Everybody go check that out if you haven't.
Do we want to hit any of these other topics before we call it? We probably have time for one more.
So we could maybe do this top one.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is one that, I mean, this is kind of a hearty topic or
it's meaty. You'll be glad you've listened to the end of the podcast.
Sure.
He said, hopefully.
Some incentive to get through this nonsense. And this is one that we probably even should have done with Brian here. And also maybe we'll do a follow up with John next month, to get his take. Cause he probably has
something similar with scam stuff.
It's similar, but also different in certain contexts. And I'd be interested to see how that differs with him. So I wanted to talk a little bit about feedback, comments.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
5-star rate and review.
Yeah. So, you know, with Scam School in particular, you know, we pay a lot of attention to the YouTube comments.
Yeah.
For better or worse. I kind of adopted that habit from Brian, because Brian's always given those comments a lot of weight and attention.
Sure. I mean, that's where probably most of the scam school community is.
Right, yeah. Like, none of our other distribution platforms are particularly conducive to discussion.
No.
Right? Test Tube, there are like 3 comments on any given episode.
Maybe. Vessel, it's like...
Vessel, there's literally 2 comments for every one, and it's the first one goes, first! Yeah. And then the second one's like, dude, what are you doing?
Yeah.
Stop. It's somebody going, second!
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And there's like no moderation on Vessel or whatever. Mm-hmm. So, like, I've gone through a few stages of reacting to these comments, right? So
sure.
When I first started, I didn't care.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just straight up, like, I'll look at them.
But yeah, what you're saying is not registering with the person.
Like, I'm just happy to be making stuff that people are watching.
Mm.
And then as time went on, I started to care more and started taking things personally, which is a dangerous way to go, especially for something as visible as these things, you know, like that's one of the reasons why I was so trepid about doing Tay Allen's music video last year, because I was just like, oh,
there's going to be, like, among the people who have issues about the song, those people will be in overdrive about the video elements that you are in control of.
And, like, my name is probably going to be in the comments or in the description or whatever. Yeah. And, like, who knows who's going to take what, how, and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went through a period of going through and, like, responding to a lot of comments. And my responses have evolved over time. You know, at first I'd kind of have an edge to my comments a little bit.
Okay.
But I would also
a little pepper.
Yeah. Or salt.
Or salt.
If you rather getting a little salty.
You pushed it is what you're saying.
Yeah. But I very intentionally, dressed it up in such a way that anybody can see that, like, I'm the reasonable one, right? Like, somebody would post something like Insidious or whatever, and then I would just be like, hey, look, like, we hear you, I'm hearing your feedback, but this is not particularly constructive. Like, can you possibly, you know, restructure your comment in such a way that I can do something with this? Because I make the episodes and I hear you.
Right.
Right.
You're just being critical to the point of not helping with, like, solve whatever the underlying issue is.
Yeah. Like, obviously everybody who sees his comment knows that he's not trying to make the show better. Right. Yeah. He's just venting his own personal frustrations in some capacity.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm framing it in such a way that I believe that he's trying to make the show better. And just to point out how disparate his actual comment is from what would be useful.
Sure.
And then, like, I've kind of come back around on it where, like, I feel like there's nothing that the commenters can do to validate me. Like, I don't need validation anymore.
Mm.
And honestly, like, as far as the large portion of the commenting audience, particularly on Scam School, like, I don't have a particular respect for the audience.
Okay.
And I don't really have a particular respect for their opinion. I'm sure there are a lot of reasonable people who watch the stuff and don't comment ever.
Right.
Right? Because, like,
if it was reasonable, they wouldn't have any reason to leave a message that's like, one way or the other.
Yeah, and if you look at, like you and I, we watch a lot of Giant Bomb content.
Mm-hmm.
I almost never make comments on their stuff, and I love their stuff.
Yeah.
I watch it every day. And so there are probably tons of people like that who do watch our things. And also, this is kind of exacerbated by the fact that I am the only person to the best of my knowledge, who is going through moderating all of the comments on the YouTube channel. Because at some point last year, I opened up the YouTube channel and saw that the flagged as spam was broken because there were so many because nobody ever went in there and nobody ever cleaned it out.
Oh.
So I went through over the course of like 2 or 3 months and just went through
cleared out that whole queue.
Every flagged spam, which was thousands of comments over all of the videos.
Mm-hmm.
And it was even at that point, once I cleared it out, it was so broken that even though there were no flagged comments, it would still say like 600 or 120 or something.
Geez.
Finally, like over the past month or two, like it's kind of like the YouTube system has cleared its cache or whatever, and it's kind of been like, oh, now you actually have zero flagged comments.
I see.
But I go in there every couple of days, and I've also started banning people who I'm like, you just contribute nothing to this except for toxicity.
Mm-hmm.
So there are like 10, 15 people who are banned, which is great because there was one dude who was just like being a real asshole. And I was like, hey, dude, like,
You're out of here.
Yeah. I was like, you're banned. So yeah. I hope you got something out of this. And then he was like, oh, lol, whatever. And then that was the last comment that he ever made on the channel.
Sure.
Which felt really, really good to me.
I guess maybe he just didn't believe that you were a person who could do that or that YouTube had that capability.
I guess because I do use my personal account for commenting. I don't use like the Scam School channel, except for on very rare occasions where like that the impact of that response really
warrants
demands
it being said
Scam
that
School.
Sure.
Right, like where it's clearly like some 8-year-old kid who's like, please comment, and I have like a really good like comment. I'm like, Brian's not gonna do this, so I'm just gonna type this out on the Scam School thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, and then you know, I also have flagged words that if they come up, you know, their comment goes into approval mode, so nobody sees it until I've approved it.
Mm-hmm.
And so almost all the comments get filtered through me at some point in time.
Oh, wow.
And you know, I've had to develop internal systems of like what's okay and what's not. You know, like I end up deleting a lot of comments that are flagged for like for self-promotion stuff, like
sure,
hey, check out
my
channel.
Yeah.
But I've even recently started loosening up on that a little bit, especially if I can tell that their channel is magic related.
Okay.
Because
then they're at least like, you know what, like I guess if you like, this kind of makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, my hard and fast rule is if you contribute to the conversation in any capacity, I don't care how much you self-promote, I'll allow the comment.
Sure.
Right? Like, if you make it clear to me that you watched the video and you're commenting about the video in some capacity, it's totally fine. But if you just come in and you're like, hey, check out my channel, usually I would delete those if they're flagged as spam. If they're not flagged as spam, a lot of times I won't see it or I won't care.
Mm-hmm.
But these days also, I feel like we are in such a position that it is important for us to cater the burgeoning magic community in young people.
Mm.
And so I think like if people aren't going to get noticed through our channel, where are they going to get noticed?
Okay.
So I think we have a little bit of responsibility to help allow that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's the best venue for that kind of thing. I wish there was maybe like a community spotlight sort of thing that we could do.
Huh.
But I don't know where we'd
that
even
seems,
begin.
Right, because I guess maybe if there was a non like actual magic trick element to that, because if someone sends in a magic trick, that could be a Scam School episode.
Mm.
But if someone's like, check out my routine or something, maybe that's like, that could be a community thing, or maybe, I don't know, that's a small package on Behind the Scam, or I don't, like there are, it's like not, it's a good idea to find ways for the community to more interact with the videos.
Mm-hmm.
Like with the giveaways, kind of the idea with giveaways is to increase the community through the email list, but definitely a more active and I don't know the better word for it, but something a little less predatory, a little less so, because the email list is for scam stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And if there was something that could get people feeling more involved and it wasn't just through the medium of buy this thing or get this discount or whatever, like that makes sense. That's a good idea. I don't know what that, this is a little eye opening because I never realized how much of an active hand you had in the YouTube comments. Sometimes when I have an episode come up, I will, you know, I'll look at the comments and generally just see if there's anything terrible. I think the only times I've ever deleted anything was like on the book test, someone was trying to share a link to a BitTorrent of how the book test works or something, and so that was right out.
Right.
Or something that's like obviously spam, right? Like, oh, check out my fucking tinyurl.ru fucking scam, actual scam shit.
Right.
But otherwise, even things like the, you know, check out my channel, I don't really touch, which I guess is pretty similar to the guidelines that you've mentioned, but I've never made it a point to be like, I need to filter through this stuff so actively.
Yeah, I also get rid of comments that are like comments that I find particularly disrespectful to our guests and stuff, which some episodes get that a lot more than other episodes.
Sure.
But I try to get some of those just because it's in our best interest to not have that kind of stuff there.
Right. Though Brian has done, the way he's responded to that has more been like, instead of deleting the comments, just being like, hey, can you, like, in a reply, hey, can you please show more respect to the people who are on the show? Or, you know, some pretty tender, like, slap on the wrist. Because part of it is they just don't expect anyone to read it or to respond or to have any sort of accountability. Mm-hmm. So having a reply from the channel itself is like, oh, shit, dog. Like, maybe that's not the best thing to do anymore.
Sure. And there's
compared to like inflaming them of just like, oh, they're going to delete my comments, which is something I worry about with like,
you'd be surprised how few people even notice. You'd be surprised. Yeah. I think
there's not a real great system on YouTube for like all of my comments. I need to keep an eye on them.
Even if you leave a comment, sometimes it's hard to go back and find your own comment on that video.
Yeah.
But and, you know, there's something to say about a certain element of negative reinforcement because sometimes people are just, they don't know, or they're in a bad mood or whatever, and then they come back and they're like, hey, I'm sorry, or whatever.
Yeah.
But at some point, like, Brian's not going to see all of that stuff.
There's a lot. I mean, it's hundreds every multiple times a week, and
And if you think about it, like for every disparaging comment of that toxicity that's on there that Brian doesn't respond to, makes us look bad. Like if somebody goes to one of our videos and they look at the comments and they see, you know, like really horrible, terrible stuff, like on some levels, some of them are going to go with a knowing like, oh, that's just the YouTube ecosystem.
But at a certain number, it turns into like, wow, you guys, it's not that we left the comments there that is the issue. It's that it gives credibility and legitimacy to like,
with the .com.net.
It gives credence to like what they're saying, and it makes that seem like that is the community's voice when probably the community's voice would be nothing like any of the comments because most of the community is not even there.
Sure. Yeah. And so I've kind of flipped on it and I've gone to a point of just like, I don't really care what any of them have to say. I try to clean up stuff when I can, but
Is there like, do you see a positive side? I'm not saying because I'm seeing you as some like hardened cynic, but this segment has sort of just like everybody is at best a zero. And you know, we get comments about the ads, especially lately. We've been getting maybe a little more comments about the ads. Does any of that like ring positive?
There are definitely, so we definitely have some regulars, mm-hmm. which is nice to see. There are some people who, you know, it's funny. There's one guy who literally shares every video that we post, oh. and every time he shares it, it gets flagged as spam because he does it on every video.
Oh.
So every time we post a video, I go into the flagged and approve his share, which is really great.
Yeah.
We definitely have some people who are like, oh, I recognize your name. I recognize your thing.
Yeah.
And we have some really awesome members of the community, like Johnny Boys, who we didn't get it on the last Bizarre Briefing, but he gave Brian an award.
Yeah, the Johnny Boz Award.
Yeah, Johnny Boz, and he had like his own award show thing, and then Brian sent in like a video clip of like, hey, thanks for this award. And so he finally sent like the physical award, which is downstairs, and it's really great. And like, I think he's super awesome. And like he found Scam School, and it kind of you know, sparked up some kind of interest in magic through that. Mm-hmm. And I think stuff like that is really great, because it's like, it's a really positive contribution to the community.
Yeah.
And it's really fun to see. I think sometimes people will post like links to a trick they did. Like the other day, I watched some link, dude just posted a link, and I was like, all right, well, let me see what it is. And it was him doing like a card trick, and it was actually pretty well done. And
yeah.
although I don't know much about magic, like I could piece together exactly how he did it, but I thought it was like well performed, and mm-hmm. and that was interesting to see. And I think it's an interesting space for members like that who have something to contribute.
Yeah.
But it also, the freeness to access, it kind of is a lightning rod for people who just have nothing better to do.
Yeah.
Than to pretend like, I mean, it's also this kind of weird thing where we are such a big distributor of content, and yet we pay that much close attention to the comments, and there are only what, like six people in our credits, and
yeah, if that.
Yeah, and like one of them's Roberto, who only does sound for Scam School, and
right.
You know, it's like you edit a full episode, or I edit a full episode, and Brian and John come up with the idea, mm-hmm. and then Brian performs it, and you know, we also do all the shooting. So like, if anybody has any kind of complaint about any side of the production,
it's us.
Like, we see that shit, and like, it hits because we know exactly what went into everything, and we are responsible for everything. So it's like these, you know, I talked about this a bit on one of the last My So-Called Ape Lives that I was on.
Okay.
But
Roberto.
Yeah. So if you want to hear a little bit more about that, go look that up. Maybe we'll have it in the show notes or something. And you know, I think a lot of the problems with internet discussion, particularly on YouTube, is just the lack of a sense of community. And I feel like a lot of people go into our video and they see this dumb spiky haired dude drinking beer and acting weird.
Right. And they think it's a big thing, machine that is like impenetrable with their words, when it's sure. the exact opposite.
And it's you know, it's got like Discovery's backing. They're like, it's basically a TV show. Like
right.
you don't go on Twitter and say like, man, American Idol is real dumb this week, and then you don't expect like all
Simon Cowell.
Simon Cowell's like,
oi, mate. Oh,
what?
What?
I put a lot of work into this week's episode of American Idol.
That's my camera work. Right, like that doesn't happen.
Right. And so there's, you know, like we see that stuff, and like it's personal for us, and it's very impersonal for them.
Yeah.
And
especially if maybe they're like a longer time fan and they know of the old episodes where every episode had like 2 minutes of credits because so many people worked on it in the past.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe they just don't understand that like it has shrunk down so much over the past 2 years. Right. Mm. It is just that much more personable and easier to contact.
Yeah. And also for me, there's a disconnect with the audience when I see so many people who are like, I mean, like every remix episode that we post, they're like, "Is this a re-upload?" And it's like, "Yeah, we've been doing this for a year, man." Like,
we're getting that
if you're subscribed, you should know this.
You should know that's what that is, right?
And then
we're getting the same for Behind the Scam, where it's like, "Oh, I'm unsubscribing because this is just an ad." But it's like, A, that's what Behind the Scam has always been, and B, like, it's just one more video that you can just not watch. Mm-hmm. It isn't really taking up time that some other video would occupy. And we're, you know, with the giveaways, with news and updates, like, it's trying to be have an interesting, latchable amount of information and content. So it isn't just an ad every week, because that that idea on its own kind of doesn't fly, you know, like. Every week we're going to do a Scam Stuff ad. Well, like, no, you got to have more than that, dude. Otherwise, like, people will rightfully be upset. But that's not what Behind the Scam is trying to be, is my take on it.
Yeah. And yeah, I think when we get, like, a lot of comments like that where it's just, like, people who don't get it, like, I feel like... my brain is trying to get me to feel like the audience is dumb, right? Like, they're an uninformed audience, which the informed audience has no reason to comment, of course.
Right. And if they're uninformed, like, what else are they gonna, like, that's what you would do if you didn't know any better.
Right.
So at some point it needs to be more of a guiding hand, but then there's only so long that a person can do that.
Yeah. And you know, I've always been a fan of just, like, I mean, I think there's something we say about the comments, and I think even in some of the most garbage comments, you can extract something useful out of it, more or less.
Generally.
But you know, I've always been a fan of, like, just shut them down. I'd be totally fine if there were no comments. I know Brian would hate it. Right.
Yeah.
But, like,
and I feel like, I mean, there's probably a couple more reasons why that, like, may not be a great thing, but
sure.
Definitely when they're so personal, the benefits of not having any more comments could be, like, would be a nice silver lining of just, you know, I don't have to deal with X, Y, or Z complaints or
types. Think about how much time I would save in not having to deal with all these comments.
How much
I go in there every day.
Really?
Yeah. And you know, sometimes I'll just spend a couple minutes just, like, flipping through, but a lot of times, like, if they're flagged, like, I go through every link because I want to make sure that if I'm deleting this, I'm deleting something that should be deleted.
Sure.
And a lot of times I have to sit there and parse what they're saying to say, like, is this contributing to anything? And, you know, sometimes I do spend a bit of time in there, but not always.
Yeah. But I also think, but yeah, that would definitely not happen or fly.
Right. But it's a fun fantasy for me.
Sure.
Something where I'm like, ooh, man, that'd be real nice. He didn't just do what Total Biscuit does. He shut down his comments, but then he jumped everything over to Reddit. And then so that way, like, if, like, I feel like although Reddit has its own problems.
Right.
Like,
Reddit and Total Biscuit have all of their own, like, issues. But
sure. But, like, that's a far more conducive place for discussion than YouTube.
It's kind of like on Twitch. Or when you and I live stream or something, right? Where we don't use the Twitch chat or the YouTube chat generally, because it's garbage monsters full of awful people who, like, are totally okay. Though it's even worse with the live streaming because it's so ephemeral and there's so less accountability for what people go and do.
It was like an early Periscope. Because early Periscope, it was just people would troll, like, the most recent broadcast and stuff.
Really? Oh, I didn't.
Yeah, and so you just have, like, people come in and say, like, horrible shit.
Mm-mm.
And there's no repercussion. Now they have, like, block features and
oh, that's good.
And also just, like, the community has evolved in such a way that, like,
that stuff doesn't really
surface.
Sure.
Yeah.
But, like, I know, at least for me personally, that's why I really try not to use the Twitch chat, because the people who are there probably don't care about the way that I stream or what I stream or whatever. And on the inverse, like, the people in the chat room are the people who I would want to be the community that is on screen or that I look at. Mm-hmm. Not taking the default community definitely has its pros, but also, like, it's kind of weird to have to put on my screen, hey, you got to go to this site and use this room and, like, go to a different chat thing and not use Twitch's integrated, like, the whole reason for Twitch, like, being a thing. Mm-hmm. Don't do that, please. You're not going to even know you said anything.
You're right. Yeah, I do feel like out of all the comments that I do appreciate is Twitter comments, because then people are forced to take it personally. Like, mm-hmm. they have to find you and they have to say, I'm talking specifically to you.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you this thing. That stuff's good. But YouTube comments,
fuck them.
Yep.
Yeah.
They're the worst.
They can be bad. That's my take on it. Mm-hmm. I mean, definitely, right? Like, not there's not a disagreement here, I'm a shade more neutral on it than you, but also, gotcha. Like, you've been in that pool for longer.
Yeah. For today's vessel launch of Skin Skull Remix, we did Psychic Surgery. Mm-hmm. And for that, I had to go download Brian's Turkish TV appearance that was on his personal channel. Uh-huh. And I was like, Brian, you gotta moderate these comments. This is real bad.
Yeah.
This is really bad.
Because that's a pretty old clip.
Yeah, it's like 6 years old or seven, something like that.
Yeah. Waffleopagus says, what about keeping an eye on Twitch and just interacting in IRC? Problem is, like, I've done that, and it's low volume on Twitch, right, for me, mm-hmm. because I'm not a big person on Twitch. And so it's a high percentage of abuse when someone randomly comes in, and, like, I could, but, like, that stuff still gets to me and I still see it. Except now nobody else would see it on screen. And then I'm just sitting over here, like, kind of defeated because someone called me something. So, like, definitely doable, but not a great solution either.
I've also kind of backed out of our IRC stuff.
You've been, yeah, you've continued the I was going to say retreat, but that's maybe a little harsh.
It's more or less accurate.
Yeah. You're, like, it's very specific when I see you in the chat room, I feel like.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of it of just, you know, there's a certain point where I watched Night Attack all the time, and I knew all the names in chat, and we all had a lot of fun and mm-hmm. all that stuff. But as time has gone on, like, I just feel like, I'm just not particularly stimulated by the discussion that's happening on chat sometimes. Mm-hmm. And it's just work to me.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Sure.
But, I mean, it's great for stuff like this.
Oh, yeah. No, the people who are watching this live right now are the best.
Oh, yeah.
And we love them significantly more than everybody else. Wink. Wink. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that it?
I think that's it. Just
We are flirting with 2 hours.
Hey, you know what? Like, jam-packed episode. We had special guests.
Yeah.
We had all kinds of stuff.
Right. Other things.
Yeah. Oh, I just want to make note real quick. Yeah. This latest Scam School episode with Kelsey.
This was the card flipping.
Yeah. It was a great, like, tight episode. Really awesome.
But
420th episode.
Yeah, buddy.
Oh, I was like, yeah. I was looking at the doc and I was like, yes, I have this one.
You have the 420 episode. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was a lot of fun.
You even snuck in a very funny,
yes,
reference. Start watching everybody's debauchery.
Hey, 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 hey.
Which is great. I have a real hard time coming up with the coming up messages.
Yeah, I kind of wish we just got rid of them.
Man, this is going into a way longer topic that we could do another time. Probably.
Yeah. Well, and yeah, and I'll add that to next month because we had like I went through a full redesign process of a lot of the structural ligaments in Scam School episodes and like developing new assets for like transitions and specifically how the transitions happen and like how we get from point A to point B
From the way they are now or from the old way
from the way that they were given to me
right okay.
from the previous production company and that's one of the remnants. I mean, when I took over, I changed the text because they were still using the "You Are Loved" text, which is like the original Scam School text, which
kind of grungy.
I really, really strongly dislike that font.
Sure.
I think that font still might be used for.
I think we use it for the subscribe at the very end or something like that.
No, we definitely don't. Because that's a font that I bought.
Right.
And I think that's actually the font that's the Scam School remix font.
Oh.
It's just like a grungier variant of it. But the "You Are Loved" font like reads like rough. '90s. Like, hey, I got a computer, I can make something now.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the whole coming up thing and then like some kind of witty thing is definitely a holdover from the old style. And sure. I think this is a longer
discussion about ways that the show can evolve both on and off camera. But
yes,
I think there are definitely avenues worth exploring.
Stay tuned for the August edition of the Bizarre Briefing.
Brandt, your Twitter.
Yo, you can find me on Twitter at Gatowag, GATOWAG.
And that's your YouTube is also Gatowag, right?
That's a fact.
You should check out, you did that, I mentioned it earlier in the show, a little video review of your battery bank.
Mm-hmm.
And I liked how informal and more casual it was compared to like a The Verge sort of article, which is like, it's got X amount of milliamp hours and it is this and that and very technical. Like it was a very intimate sort of review, but with a really, really well done visuals. And if you aren't already following Brandt on YouTube at Gatowag, you should check him out there. What was the impetus to do that? Just like
I've always enjoyed Marques Brownlee. He's
MKBHD.
MKBHD on YouTube. Mm-hmm. He does a lot of like tech reviews, phone reviews mostly, but some other stuff. Mm-hmm. And I really like his style. And I kind of thought about like, oh, could I even do this? And then when I moved into the new apartment, I had to buy a bunch of new stuff. So I was on Amazon quite a bit.
Mm.
And I saw some video reviews from other people on Amazon. I was
They're
like,
not good.
This is garbage.
All of them are bad.
This is really bad.
They're just the worst.
So I was just like, I can do this.
So you submitted it to Amazon?
I did, yeah.
Oh, that's cool. I didn't realize that.
Yeah. And so, yeah, also like the reason that it's so casual is because I do not feel particularly qualified to talk about the technical aspects of products and stuff like that. And also like, you know, we talk about this external battery. I've used three external batteries in my entire life.
Sure. You're not an authority on
what
the best one in the world is.
I can't tell you why this one is better than other portable batteries, but I can tell you
this one and it's gonna be good.
Yeah, I can tell you why you might need a portable battery and this is a perfectly fine one to use. So I don't know. It's been kind of well received as far as my usual like just personal stuff goes. So maybe I'll do one or two more, but you know, who knows.
It was a fun. I liked it. But yeah, I don't know how much is in that.
Yeah.
You know.
Who knows?
Who knows?
And also, I'm gonna post something soon on there. That is like a project that I should have finished a billion years ago, and it's just. It's a thing that I can't talk about right now, but you'll see it and be like, oh, okay.
Yeah. Cool. Okay. Very awesome. Yeah. You can find me on Twitter, at Brycas, B-R-Y-C-A-S. And if you're looking for something else, you could subscribe to my Twitch. which is twitch.tv/Bryce, B-R-Y-C-S. Or like, there's another thing, like with the Twitch stuff, like I'm using Sergeant Muffin's RTMP streaming stuff so that people could go to diamondglove.tv and see me stream there, and it's low lag and it looks better. Definitely having a Twitch option is great. And some people like aren't set up with an account on diamondclub.tv, so they don't have like a way to get alerts when if somebody goes live. So if you're interested on even just like getting like a quick alert, follow me on Twitch, twitch.tv/Bryce, because subscribe is like the $5 a month thing, which is like, damn, I don't stream that much.
Only for suckers. Yeah. Suckers subscribe.
Hear that, Chad's audience.
Have fun with your pizza emoji.
Does he have a pizza emoji?
Yeah, he totally does.
Of course he does. You can find this show at ll-dd.co/tbb. You know what?
Rolls off the tongue.
Fuck that. Neshcom. go to neshcom.com/tbb. I'm going to move shit over there.
And look for us on iTunes.
And on iTunes. Yeah. Ow. Give us a 5-star rate and review. Because we said so.
But don't. I was gonna jump into we have concerns. But don't actually review the show. Instead, tell us about.
I think it was the type of comment, so we know what episodes kind of. Right. Yeah. But
write whatever you want.
Yeah.
Fine. Freeform poetry.
Fucking get haiku.
There you go.
Try haiku. That'll fit in the character limit, probably.
Probably.
And so until next time, the guys behind the cameras are in front of the microphones. Bye.
Stay till after the credits.
You can hear that sweet diamondclub.tv stinger.
Bye.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.